Infectious disease causes the bacterial, viral, helminthic and protozoal infections. So before starting for the infectious disease, we will see some of the terminologies used while studying infectious disease. A pathogen is a microorganism that is able to cause disease in a plant, animal or insect. Pathogenicity is the ability to produce disease in a host organism. Microbes express their pathogenicity by means of their virulence, a term which refers to the degree of pathogenicity of the microbe. Determinants of virulence of a pathogen, they are any of its genetic or biochemical or structural features that enable it to produce disease in a host. The mechanism of bacterial pathogenesis, it depends on various factors such as invasiveness and toxigenesis. Now, invasiveness is the ability to invade tissues through various entries. Ingestion, that is the fecal-oral route. Examples are Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio, Clostridium. And inhalation, that is the respiratory mode resulting from Mycobacterium tubercle. Trauma, in case of burn cases, that Clostridium tetani. Arthropod bite by the mosquito flea causes malaria. Sexual transmission, HIV, HBsAg, gonorrhea. Iatrogenic, that is by the needle prick or blood transfusion, that is HIV and hepatitis B virus. Maternal neonatal cause, that is HIV, HBV and Neisseria. So these are the modes of how the tissue gets infected by various microorganisms. Second is toxigenesis, which is the ability to produce toxins. Two types of toxins produced by bacteria are exotoxins and endotoxins. The bacterial toxins are transported by the blood and lymph and they cause the cytotoxic effects at the tissue sites. Some bacterial toxins may also act at the site of colonization and they play a role in invasion. So now we'll look at the causes of infection. First, the bacteria. Bacteria are microscopic single-celled organisms that thrive in diverse environment. They lack the nuclei and endoplasmic reticulum. Their cell walls are relatively rigid, composed either of two phospholipid bilayers with a peptidoglycan layer sandwiched in between, that is a gram-negative species, or a single bilayer covered with peptidoglycan, the gram-positive bacteria. The bacteria range in size from 0.2 to 2 micrometer. The various bacterial forms comprising the morphology of all bacteria are as follows. First, cocci, the spherical or oval in shape. They often appear in groups of 2, 4 or 8 in grape-like clusters, that is the staphylococci, or in chains, that is streptococci. Second is bacillus, they are rod-shaped in different manifestations, that is slim like Mycobacterium tubercle or plump, that is E. coli, or they may be pointed or with rounded ends. Third is the helical bacteria. They have distinctive morphological windings including Spirillia, Borrelia, Treponema and Leptospira. Last are the pleomorphic bacteria. They have got no distinct shape, example Chlamydia or Rickettsia. There are various bacterial infections. They are caused by the respiratory infections. The most common causative bacterial infections are caused by Haemophilus influenza and Mycobacterium tuberculosis. H. influenza is gram-negative coccobacilli, while M. tuberculosis is acid-fast bacilli. So the acid-fast staining and gram staining are the most commonly stains used for diagnosing different types of bacteria. Second is the gastrointestinal infections. The major causes of bacterial enteritis are E. coli, Salmonella, Shigella, Clostridium difficile and Vibrio cholerae. The pyogenic infections, the bacteria causing them are Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, Clostridium perfringens, Clostridium septicum and Clostridium tetani. The sexually transmitted infections, bacteria causing them are Neisseria gonorrhea, Treponema pallidum and Haemophilus decreyi. Second is the virus. Viruses are the non-cellular genetic elements that depend on the host cell metabolism for the replication. That is, they are obligate intracellular parasites. They are classified by the nucleic acid content of the core, whether it is RNA or DNA, and shape of the protein coat or capsid, which can be spherical or cylindrical. Common ways that viruses spread from person to person include the respiratory viral infections. This is a breathing in of airborne droplets contaminated with a virus. The SARS-CoV-2 virus, that is a subacute respiratory syndrome causing COVID virus 2, responsible for the present global pandemic, is the recent example which you all are aware of. Others are the rhinovirus and the influenza virus. The gastrointestinal infections, rotavirus, norovirus and enteric adenovirus, responsible for viral enteritis after ingestion of food or drinking water contaminated with these viruses. The sexually transmitted are herpes virus 1-2 causing herpes, and HIV which causes AIDS, and papilloma virus which causes condyloma acuminata, cervical dysplasia and neoplasia. Then virus also spread with a direct transmission from person to person by a virus host such as a mosquito, tick or field mouse. The touching surfaces or body fluids contaminated with a virus. Examples are chickenpox, common cold, conjunctivitis, hepatitis A and B, herpes simplex which causes cold sores, influenza, measles, mononucleosis, pertussis and adenorhinovirus. The protozoa. Protozoa are single-celled organisms endowed with the motility, pliable plasma membranes and complex cytoplasmic organelles. They also spread through various routes. First is the fecal route. Examples are Entamoeba histolytica and Giardia lamblia. The sexually transmitted protozoa are Trichomonas vaginalis. Bloodborne infections are caused by the blood-sucking insect, that is the Plasmodium species, which causes malaria, and Leishmania species by the blood-sucking insects. Contact infections with the oocyte shedding kittens or by eating cyst-ridden undercooked meat that causes the Toxoplasma gondii. Last is the helminths. Helminths are parasitic worms. They are the most common infectious agents of humans in the developing countries. Their life cycles are complex. Most alternate between the sexual reproduction in the definitive host and the asexual multiplication in an intermediary host or the vector. Helminths share numerous characteristics that contribute to the parasitic quality, including the presence of the attachment organs. The parasitic intestinal helminths can be divided into three groups, which include nematodes, that is roundworms. They include Ascaris, hookworms and strongylides among the intestinal worms, and Filaria and Trichinella among the tissue invaders. Second are cystodes, that is the tapeworms, also called flatworms, include pork, beef and fish tapeworms, and the cystic tapeworm larvae, that is the cystic cerci and hydrated cyst. The trematodes, that is flukes, they include oriental liver and lung flukes and the blood-dwelling cystosomes. So, about all these infections, we will be taught detail in the microbiology classes. We will only discuss the cysticercosis over here. The others, including malaria, tuberculosis, and all will be taken separately. Cysticercosis. The cysticercosis refers to tissue infection after exposure to the eggs of Tinea solium, the pork tapeworm. The disease is spread via the oral route through contaminated food and water and is primarily a foodborne disease. There are two host life cycle. Human beings are the only definitive host where the worm reaches the sexual maturity, and both humans and pigs can act as intermediate host in which the worm does not reach the sexual maturity. The T. psyllium tapeworms consist of a head, that is a scolex, and hooklets which attach to the intestinal wall, a neck and many flat segments called the proglottids. They contain both the male and female reproductive organs. New proglottids are developed behind the scolex. The most distal proglottids are mature and they contain many eggs which detach and are shed in the feces. Transmission. The T. psyllium can be transmitted by ingestion of larval cyst or eggs with distinct outcomes. First, the larval cyst called the cysticerci are ingested in the undercooked pork and they attach to the intestinal wall, where they develop into mature tapeworms. These can grow to many meters in length and produce mild abdominal symptoms. The parasitic life cycle is completed here and cysticercosis does not develop. Second is when the intermediate host, the pigs or humans, they ingest eggs in food or water contaminated with human feces, the larvae hatch, penetrate the gut wall, disseminate hematogenously and encyst in many organs, giving rise to the clinical symptoms of cysticercosis. The most serious manifestations result from the encystment in the brain called neurocysticercosis, convulsions, increased intracranial pressure and other neurologic disturbance may occur. During the viable phase, the cyst do not cause the marked inflammation or symptoms. As the cyst degenerate, they lose the ability to modulate the immune response and result in an immune attack and tissue injury and edema. Eventually, the cyst either resolve or form a calcified granuloma, which is associated with seizures if it is located in the brain. In short, the cysticerci themselves are not the cause of the symptoms, but it is the inflammatory response that is triggered, usually late when they degenerate. This is the figure which shows how the infection occurs. The eggs, the humans, they secrete, they pass on the eggs or the gravid proglottids in the feces and they are passed into the environment. The embryonated eggs or the gravid proglottids are ingested by the pigs. In the pigs, the oncospheres hatch and they penetrate the intestinal wall and circulate to the musculature. The oncospheres develop into the cysticerci in the pig muscle. When the humans, they get infected by ingesting raw or undercooked infected meat. In the digestive system of the humans, the scolec attaches to the intestine and result in the adult worm formation in the intestine and eventually again passed back in the feces. The other route is the feces, which are contaminated with the eggs by the fecal-oral route. The embryonated eggs are ingested by the human host directly, so the oncospheres hatch and they penetrate the intestinal wall and circulate to musculature. And the cysticerci may develop in any organ, being more common in the subcutaneous tissues as well as in the brain and eyes. So in this second route, the cysticercosis develops. It does not develop in the first route, where only the adult worms develop in the intestinal tract. The gross pathology. The cysts are round to oval. Their grape-sized cyst usually ranging from 1 to 2 cm with an invaginated scolex with hooklets. They contain translucent to semi-translucent fluid. The cyst number vary from patient to patient and there can be hundreds in number. The cysticerci may be found in any organ, but most common locations include the brain, muscles, skin and heart. The cysticerci may develop in any voluntary muscle in humans, producing small palpable movable nodules. Invasion of muscle by cysticerci can cause myositis with fever, eosinophilia and muscular pseudohypertrophy. The ophthalmic cysticercosis, here the intraocular cyst floating freely in the vitreous humor can be seen, which causes a decreased visual acuity. Neurocysticercosis. The most common symptoms are because of the inflammatory reactions associated with the cyst degeneration. It may take many years to develop. The epilepsy, hydrocephalus, encephalitis, meningitis are other outcomes. Thank you.